district, has attended Mesa College, was also a student teacher here at City College, has gone on to UCSD, and was very successful throughout the rest of his career as an author and a poet, one which we're very proud of being a local product. He went to Harvard also, was a professor at Harvard, and has been very successful in all of his endeavors throughout his full career. It gives me a great deal of pleasure to welcome Mr. Urea with this background, especially since he's a model and really an inspiration to all of us because of his very turbulent home life in Logan Heights here in San Diego, and going on to UCSD and to practice his skills and talents as an author and a poet. He's written three novels, and probably more will come, and is also a noted poet and a lecturer in education colleges and universities. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Mr. Luis Alberto Urea.
You're saying he don't look Mexican. Said to me about three times, "I can't believe you're a Mexican." And I'll tell you the story of it, and the story of my youth, which is probably of interest to you. I've told a couple of you this story already because I've been talking for a few days, so if you heard some of this, just bear with me. You can check me and see if I'm lying. Compare the story. But I was born in Tijuana. Off Agua Caliente Boulevard, there's a little botica, and upstairs it used to be a clinic. Now it's a storehouse, but it's still there. You know, I can go to where I was born, which is kind of cool. My family lived in Colonia Independencia, if you know it. Rampa Independencia, 1002, in fact, was our little house address. And what happened was, my mom was American, my dad was Mexican. My dad was the blonde and blue-eyed one, though. One of our quirks, and they had fallen in love in San Francisco, and I always tell people, I think my mother figured that my dad was some kind of rich hacienda owner, you know, grand ranchero with charros and mariachis everywhere, but the fact was we lived on a, I wasn't around yet, they lived on a dirt street in Tijuana with outhouse and all that sort of thing. And they married in San Francisco, and she went straight from San Francisco to Tijuana. And I think it was a real shock for my mom. When I was born, they took her to the clinic. I was born by cesarean section. And my mother was used to New York City and San Francisco ways, not Tijuana ways. And this was in the 50s. I don't want to date myself, but it was in the 50s. And she always remembered that they cleaned the knives by setting fire to them. They put them in a tray full of alcohol and lit it on fire. She's just like, yeah. But when I was born, my tías, I don't know if you have mean tías, any of you, but boy, I had some really mean aunties. And they would do stuff. They would torture my mom, you know, because she would go to San Diego to work every day and then come back to Tijuana at night. And they would tell her, you know, oye, Phyllis, you know, the marijuana ranchers kidnap blonde babies. You know the La Mesa Mountain up, you can see across the border, they used to tell her that's where the marijuana ranches were, and that they were all, the marijuana was farmed by kidnapped blonde baby boys. Anyway, we came across when I was four and moved into Logan Heights. People always say I was from Barrio Logan, but I really wasn't. I was from up on the hill. National Avenue, any of you homies out there? 3935 National Avenue. And I went to St. Jude's. I've met a couple of people from St. Jude's. In fact, I don't know, I'm sure she's here, but we were just like, oh, Father Sheridan, yeah. Sister Maria, yeah. Names I've not thought about for a really long time. But we got up there when I was 4, and I came across, like a lot of people who come across to the United States, not well. I was real sick. And I had tuberculosis, German measles, scarlatina, and a couple other things all at once. What would it be? But what happened was my dad had gotten a couple of jobs. The first job he got was as a busboy at the Del Coronado Hotel. And then the next job he got was at to Starkist, canning tuna. And what happened was he would go to Starkist every morning, and my mom would go to work in Marston's, if you remember Marston's downtown, some of you old-timers before the Broadway. And they didn't have anybody who would babysit me, because everybody thought I was going to kill off all the kids, because I was like Typhoid Mary or something. So Avelino Garcia used to work next to my dad. And I have to be careful when I tell these stories, because I realize everybody, every audience has somebody who knows my family or my godparents. This blows my mind. Last year, I was talking to Mesa College. I was telling them about the Garcias, and it turned out one of the young ladies in the audience had been babysat by my godparents. We used to play in the same yard. It was just, it's hard to believe. In fact, I drove down there last night about 10 just to look at it. Avelino and his family would take me in, and my dad, on the way to the cannery, would drop me off. And then he and Avelino would go can fish, and then he'd come home and pick me up in the evenings. And in that house, as many of us know, there were all these old ladies who knew all these weird secrets, all these stinky teas and stuff they'd make, and herb poultices, they wrap you up in really smelly leaves and all this stuff, and make you eat bunches. And they healed me when I got better. And what would happen was that they not only healed me, I think, from those illnesses, but they kind of healed me my soul, too, because in those days, as today, we didn't get along real well in Logan Heights. Now, my parents didn't get along real well inside the house, so there was no place that I felt really safe except in National City at the Garcia's house on West 20th Street. What are they? Was it any West 20th Street? Down where St. Anthony's was? You remember St. Anthony's? St. Anthony's was a beautiful little church anyway. Burned down. So that's where I would go, and I would learn about gardens, and I'd learn about plants, and I would learn about animals and family and so forth there. And I think my writing career comes from that little garden more than any place else in the whole world. It comes from the garden of the Garcia family. My Nino would teach me how to make my chaca, teach me how to cut nopales, all that sort of thing. And I've carried that with me. I think it's a metaphor for me of belonging, and healing. And I think we all need it. We need some little grain of something special about our own lives, I think, to fuel us as we go on. They're my grain. My parents were a funny mix. My mom, being American, she was real American. She was like New York City, urban dilettante, fancy lady American. And we used to take that 11 bus out of Logan Heights, and my mom would wear her little white gloves, her little string of pearls and her little hat. And my dad, even though he was a güerito, he was Mexicano. He was only about me that big, But he was macho, man. And my mom, I think because my tías were so mean to her, started really disliking this Mexican stuff. And my dad, I think because everybody was so mean to him when he got across here, started hating the Americans. So my dad became militant Mexicano, and my mom became militant Norteamericana. And they never crossed again. It was like there was an armed camp in the house with the Mexicans on one side and the Americans on the other. So when I was hanging with my dad, I was Mexicano, speak Spanish. And he would check my accent. And if I said some of the stuff we say, voy a mi paica. ¿Qué baica, hombre? She always called me Lewis. It's interesting because I always tell this story. The only thing my mom, those of you who don't speak Spanish will still appreciate this. The only thing my mom learned to say in Spanish was a real mild curse, but she said it wrong. So you see my mom get really mad and she'd yell, "Que la fregando!" Which, yeah, poor mom. Anyway, all that to say that I had that childhood like a lot of you guys had, you know, in a lot of the same neighborhoods and stuff. And a lot of my nephews are still in my old neighborhoods. And, you know, they know all the new gang signs and stuff, but I don't know. We moved to Claremont when I was in about fifth grade. And I was telling this story this morning. I think I told it to some classes Friday. But, you know, I had never really understood ethnic strife real well. And Logan Heights, when I was coming up, was a very mixed and complicated neighborhood anyway, right? And people didn't get along, but it was because of our parents, because the kids got along. Something happened. You get to a certain age and you weren't supposed to hang out with people. And when I got to Claremont, it was the first time I ever heard racist stuff, ever. I'd never heard it about me. I'd heard it about other people, but I'd never heard the stuff about us. And I still remember, I told the class this morning, I didn't know I was a white boy. It didn't occur to me what we were. We just were us. And I remember getting to Claremont and hearing the word greaser for the first time. Somebody told me, "You're a greaser, man." "I'm a what?" "You're a greaser, man." And I remember thinking, and the class laughed this morning, but I thought, am I greasy? Are we greasy? And you know the weird connections you make as you're a kid? I was thinking the word wetback, and I thought, oh my God, you know, is there something wrong with us? Are we crazy? And I went home to my dad. And now it's funny to me. At the time, I was just in awe of my dad. Now I'm even more in awe of him and how quick he was. But I said, "Dad, what's a greaser?" "¿Quién te dijo eso?" I said, "Well, somebody told me I was a greaser. What is it?" And you'd expect my dad to flip out and get really angry. But this really happened. I always tell this story. It seems like a joke. But he transformed into the mad professor, you know, and stands up and says, "In America's westward expansion across the continent." I'll never forget that, you know, my book. It's like he needed a chart, you know. And he said, "The Americanos came across the country in covered wagons and stagecoaches." And he said, "But there was only one group of people technologically advanced enough to take care of those, and it was Mexicanos." He said, "So Mexicanos would fix the wagons for them and grease the axles." I don't know if it's a lie or not, but I was like, "Go, Dad!" And he said, "So that's where we got the name, you know, and they don't know that it's a badge of honor, basically." Yeah. That was my dad. He was sharp. So I went to high school, like everybody, and I was the first one to finish college. I know a lot of you here are going to be the first ones probably, and your families to do it. It's a great thing. It's a real special thing. And lately I get asked to do commencement speeches, and I've got this thing I like to do. I did it at Mesa College, in fact, last year, but I sneak a camera up there, and instead of giving a speech, I take pictures of the audience. You know, and I tell them, "You accomplished something so special. I just want a picture of you." When I graduated, it was kind of a scandal, I'll tell you, I mean a good scandal, but my father had been killed my senior year in Mexico. There's a chapter in my first book about what happened. If I had more time, I'd read it, but we have limited time. But he was killed, and I didn't know what to do. You know, I was a senior in college, and I was just blown out of my mind. I had no idea even what I was doing. And so when I graduated, I wasn't really there even. But I remember that all of the family showed up. And the homies, everybody, you know, the guys with the little sunglasses, with the cigarros, what are you, tío? Tío Luis, you know, el tío loco. And my brother came from Mexico City with a newborn baby. It was a week old. And I remember, I told this to the class this morning, looking up and seeing the little baby up in the air, you know, like, it's going to watch, right? And I realized how important that was for us, that we were going to go and do universities and stuff. It made me really feel good. son of one of my nephews. And all the other guys, you know, were all like, hey, man, I said, Billy wants to, he's read all your books, like, a pendejo. And I was thinking, no way, that's a wonderful thing. But you know how it is in your peer group where people think, oh, you think you're so smart, you have to read. So I went and sat with him at the breakfast table. And he was eating, ignoring me, you know, had a little Pendleton on. And I said, they told me you read all my books. I guess, yeah. And I said, did you like them? Maybe. And I said, you want to write, don't you? Ah, nobody can. And I said, you want to write, don't you? And he kind of went, oh. Just that little tiny, yeah, you know. And I thought, all right, here's the next generation. And they were all pushing him around and giving him goals and stuff. But I knew he was gonna do it. It's some crazy tradition. I don't know if he'll ever go to school or not. I don't know. But I know he wants to write. And I meet so many people who want to write, you know, and I always think, what a wonderful, miraculous thing to do. Tell our stories. Our stories are going away. They're going away. They're spilling away like sand out of an hourglass, you know. I was telling this class this morning about when Avelino Garcia finally died. You know, it was the same year. The year my father died, everybody seemed to die. He died, his mom died, Avelino died. I lost all of my anchors at once. But, you know, when I went to those funerals, and I'm sure you've been to them, you see the little old men and old women, you know, and in my old neighborhoods, they're the little old men, and they have the suits that they've had, like, since 1940, you know, and they get dressed up, you know those guys, and they've got the big brown shoes, and I va caminando el compadre, you know, and they have dust on their shoulders, and the old ladies have their old little veil, and they all sit together, sometimes in the back row, and you see them try to kneel, you know, que la fregando. And I realized that they were all going. They were all dying too. And all of their stories were just going away, just disappearing. And I thought, man, somebody's got to do something. You know, and it's all those old stories that the granny keeps telling you. You know, you've got some old person who keeps telling you that damn story about Pepe and the chicken, you know? And then suddenly they're dead, and you say, what was that story about Pepe and the chicken? I can't remember. And I felt like that's what was happening. You know, it was a real big moment for me as a person who wanted to write, to realize that our stories were going. Anyway, my dad died, and fairly recently my mom died too. And it's been kind of strange, because suddenly I find myself sort of being an orphan. You know, everybody's gone. And it's a weird kind of freedom, because I can't make anybody mad anymore. I know there's somebody out here, because I talked to her the other day about you talking about writing, and your family doesn't want you to write about what you got to write about. It's hard, you know. And I didn't even know it, but I sort of waited them out. They all died suddenly, and I thought, dang, I can't get in trouble anymore. But it's a terrible thing to realize. It's a very expensive kind of freedom to have. But you got to be brave, you know. If you're a chicken like me, too, you hide them in fiction. And I write, or used to write, quite a bit for the San Diego Reader, and believe me, two or three of those writers were me. And the stories were my family stories, I just changed them. I turned one guy into a woman, and I moved him out of Del Sol and put him over in Chula Vista. You know, just change details, but you can get the story out. It's an important thing, I think. Anyway, I graduated from college, and I did a whole bunch of weird stuff, because I didn't want to go to graduate school because of my dad's death. I just wanted a break. And in 1978, I met this pastor that works in Tijuana, Pastor Vaughn, some of you may even know him, who I wrote my two books about Tijuana about, essentially. And Pastor Vaughn's been working in Tijuana for 30 years with the poor, you know, in the jail, at the Tijuana garbage dump, on the street, orphanages. And friends of mine said, why don't you go to Tijuana with Juan? And I thought, hombre, I'm from Tijuana. This guy's not going to show me about my town. You know, I was real proud. I know all about Tijuana. And I didn't know anything. I thought I did. But you know, my family's been in Tijuana 75 years. And we've certainly been in San Diego 50 years. And I realized that nobody ever went into the gym. Why would you go? Nobody went to the dump. Why would you go into the dump to see what people are doing? Or why would you go up a canyon in Cartolandia or something and see what people are doing? So I went with this guy. And they were all really nice, well-meaning Baptist missionaries. But nobody spoke Spanish. I mean, nobody spoke Spanish Spanish. You know what I mean? They spoke the, you know, hola amigo, que tal, como estás? Spanish. But nobody spoke sort of like the street Spanish. And we went to this orphanage near my grandma's house, a hill over from my old house. And there was a little girl there named America, believe it or not. And she was a little blonde, blue-eyed girl. And she looked just like an Urrea. And I like to say, knowing the Urreas, there's a good chance she may have been an Urrea, I don't know. But this little girl, America, heard me speak Spanish and grabbed hold of me and said, talk to me, talk to me, talk to me. Nobody talks to me. A little clue again about writing, you know. Nobody talks to me. What she was really saying, she didn't know, was nobody listens to me. So we talked. And it was time to go. I tried to leave. And I started to walk out. And America, I call it the orphanage boot. What the kids do is they sit on your feet so you can't move, right? So,
you know, one sits that way, and then another one grabs and sits that way.
And you can't move. And America was beginning one of these kind of imprisonments where you need to get out. And I was trying to get rid of her, basically. I hate to admit. But I said, look, let me go. I'll come back next week and we'll speak. And she said, you promise me? And I said, yeah, I promise. I'll come back next week. Really? And I didn't mean it. I just wanted to. And I went walking out, and this pastor, Pastor Vaughn, was waiting for me. And he said, what did you say to that child? I said, well, I told her I'd come back. And he said, don't you ever lie to my children again. Well, I know, I was like, yeah. I said, And he said, don't you know that little girl's going to wait all week for you? And then she's going to wait the next week, and she's going to wait 3 weeks, and she'll wait months, and several years down the road, she'll still remember you and wonder why you didn't care. I thought, oh, great. So I went back, and then I went back, and then I went back, and like the third time I went back, he had a family he wanted me to meet, and then, hey, why don't you stick around and come to the orphanage? And I went to a second orphanage, and then one night he said, hey, why don't you come Thursday morning? So I went, and then why don't you come on Saturday? And pretty soon I was doing that full time. And I became his translator. And I did not realize how important language really was. I mean, I had been TAing, you know, I'd been here at the high school, I'd been here, I had been at Mesa, I had been at Southwestern. But I didn't really realize how important language was until I knew that I was the one person everybody could talk to. And I remember thinking, and I've told this before, that when you have that gift of language, you are told the unspeakable because people tell you the stuff that nobody can hear. And it's a really weird thing because as a writer, you get that too, or at least if you're a writer like me. I mean, I don't think everybody gets that kind of stuff, but, you know, people come and tell you things. I feel like a priest, you know, because they come for confession, you know, at least guess what I did. I've never met this person before, and I'm looking at them like, dang. But they do, because people want to be heard. So I started to translate, and all this is leading up to something, believe it or not. I'm not just rambling mad at them. This pastor said to me one day, you know, very few people who know these folks can write like you do. And no one's ever told their story. Why don't you keep some journal? And I thought, wow, what a good idea. Journals about stuff. I kept over 1,500 pages finding the journal. But one day I was writing the Tijuana dump, and this basurero was going by, a nice man. He stopped and he was looking at me. And he came over and says, oye, ¿qué estás haciendo? What are you doing? I said, well, I'm writing in my journal. He said, ¿qué es eso? What is it? I said, it's a diary. He said, what's that? I said, well, it's a book where you write down the stuff that you see every day. I said, wait a minute. You're writing about here? And I said, oh, yeah. And he looked around and he said, you're writing about these people? And I said, yeah. He said, you're writing about me? Uh-oh. And I said, yeah. And he looked at me, you know, and he said, is anybody going to read it? And I said, I don't know. I hope so. And he looked at me, you know, and I remember thinking, we're either going to have a fight or we're going to hug each other. Doing that look, you know, when they lean back. And I thought, uh-oh. And he looked at me and he said, you know, good. He said, you write it down. He said, you write it down because I was born in the trash. He said, I work in the trash. I'm going to die aquí en el dompe. And they're going to bury me here in the dompe. He said, nobody will ever know I lived. He said, so you write it down and tell them I was here. And well, I remember thinking again, you know, is this a blessing or a curse? Because I wanted to write all kinds of other stuff. But I knew I couldn't not tell his story after that. So I tried, and I tried, and I tried. When I got hired to go teach writing at Harvard, I've told this before, but I thought I was going to be a janitor. I wrote and applied for a janitor job, and they hired me to teach writing. And I was thinking, oh. But I got there, and of course, my brothers just went crazy. You know, he's the Tijuanense going to La Harvard. He's going to go teach those guys. And I thought, what am I doing? You know, they would have never let me in as a student. How am I going to teach here? But it worked. But I had these journal notes, and I started trying to construct a book. And it was a total disaster. I've told it to every class, but, you know, I started, my first book came out in 1993. I wrote it in 1980. And I submitted it over and over and over and over and over and over and over, which is proof you have to be either stupid or crazy to write, because you got to keep telling yourself that you believe. Because everybody else tells you, we don't believe in you. You can't do this. I'll tell you two things that happened to me that I had to fight against. One of them, the first versions of the book I just sent out is Luis Urrea. And sometimes I included my mom's name, which was an Anglo name. So some of them were under Luis Urrea de Shiro, which is her name, to try to be fair to her. And I was told by an editor, if you just get rid of that Mexican name, we can market it better. Now, of course, Chicanos are a fad, so everybody wants Charles Perez on TV, right? That's not his name, you know. So, but in those days, they wanted you to get rid of the name. And I remember getting all militant, you know, because I'd come out of Mesa and had worked with Mecha and stuff, so I thought, all right, Mecha. So I thought, okay, I'll add Alberto. Luis Alberto Urrea, you know, I'll be more Mexican. I did. Which may have, I don't know if it was smart or not, you know. Now I feel pretentious because everybody's going, Luis Alberto Urrea. It just sounds kind of, but that's why it happened. I just thought, yeah, we were so mad. And the other thing that happened was a publisher told me nobody cares about starving Mexicans. And, you know, I thought, well, that's the end of my writing career, right? And I came back to San Diego and I started publishing these books in the Reader as articles. That's how all the books finally happened, was passing them through that filter. Though I have to tell you that after so many rejections and so much struggle, I gave up. And I went back to graduate school because I'd never gotten beyond a BA. I've been teaching all those years and stuff just on a BA. And I thought, well, I'll teach English, you know, I'll go get a master's degree and finish it up and teach English. And as soon as I got to grad school, they bought my book. And, you know, screwed up that too because I've been traveling a lot ever since. But one of the things they did, which you might find interesting, and this is also a true story, but the publisher that bought my book asked me to give them 12 reasons why they should publish my book. In other words, you know, how are we going to make money? How many Chicano studies are there out there? And I said, you know, they wanted to find out where they could sell the book. And I was so fed up after 10 years of this, and I think I told this story on Friday, but I only remember the first three reasons I gave them. These were the reasons. Number one, you should publish it because nobody cares about these people. And they need their story told. I said, number two, you should either publish it or reject it now, because I'll publish it someday. Just get out of my way. So I think, oh, Mr. Militant. No, no, don't clap. I was just nuts, you know. But the third reason, which was my favorite, was I wrote, God wants you to. I just didn't think it was going to happen. For some reason, it did. And Rudy and Naya and a couple of writers gave me a lot of support. And here I go. So that was a really good thing. So that's kind of the story in a real nutshell. I have limited time, so I thought I'd read you one thing, because there's so much to read from. I got 4 books out now and 2 books coming out next year. Somehow it worked. You know, if you just keep at it, it works. I don't know how it happens. People always ask me, what's the magic? And I think, well, practice and keep showing up to work. That's all you do. Really, fight. And tell your story. So I thought I'd read you a poem, if that's all right. It's not too boring. I know people kind of get afraid when they hear poems. And I've been kicking around what I'd read to you, so I thought I'd read you just a quick one about Avelino, my Nino. I was going to read you one about my mom, but it just depresses me too much. She died in 1990. It was one of those sad deaths, you know, where they lay in the bed for a week and nobody knows they're dead. And I felt real guilty, you know, because I was far away, but that happens to us too, doesn't it? Avelino, my Nino, what I told you about on West 20th Street. Some of you may even know the family, but he had this great habit. He had dentures, and when he'd laugh, pardon my language, he'd always yell, puta madre! And then he'd spit out his dentures. And he'd spit, and then he'd put them back in. And I used to wonder why my Nino was so happy all the time, because he loved life so much, until I got up with him one morning. He always got up at 4 in the morning. I'm sure you've got some of those old timers too. And I'm like, how the heck do they do it, man? And he whistled all day, but he couldn't whistle, so it was like this. All day. And he put on his hat, and he wore chanclas. He never put shoes on. He'd be out in the garden, you know, cruising around. Well, I got up with him one morning, and this was his secret. A big glass of wine before he slept. He put 2 raw eggs. He made his own wine. It was called Garcia, of course, and it was potent, man. And he'd fill a tumbler with it with 2 raw eggs. So that was my Nino. And I wrote this poem kind of in honor of him because I loved him so much. I was kind of scared of him in a way because he was so hombre, you know. And he'd always show up like with big chunks of something dead, you know, like a cabeza of a goat or something. You know? We're going to eat this. So, this is a quick poem, and then maybe we can talk if you want to chat a little bit. Avelino Garcia, a song of my elder. He watches angels bleed up pine tree saplings, rise through knotty trunks in spring at dawn's fragmented light. Nos hace falta un Emiliano Zapata. He reads the roadmaps of heaven in the chip of light in Raven's eye, across the ladybug's domed back, the universe revealed, red and curved and halved. He sops up turpentine sweat in a faded bandana, perfumes himself with the fluttered smell of grapevines, vino, olives, maíz. When thunderheads hear and heed his word, rush up the coast thick with dust, pitch electric fits, he sews the falling shadows of his homeland to his hat with drumming threads of rain. Esta lluvia me sabe a la paz. Women come to him with ills. He fills with herbs, with wine, their puckered navels, fumes the pains from their veins, forges tea that frightens tapeworms from the gut. You know that. He binds thick black-lined ankles tight in roots. They pulse their smells into the blood, unfreeze the knees of men who stay for supper. Pacho Villa, era un cabrón. Pero nunca lo He pulls his dentures free to spit into the weeds. He has adobe palms. And then, another magic. The white man's tubes screw up his nose so suddenly, pump air into his sparking brain, where black fire light. His wooden legs nailed to a bed, the one man never meant to greet a sunrise on his back. His eyes are hammered flat. I watch him. He turns to desert sand. His color bleeds up IV satellites from a nipple in his hand. Avelino wings with Brother Crow over memory's floodplain, bedpan unattended, his silent song concealed beneath the edge of the sheet. He will not look at me. He demands a wordless leaving, angry sleep, because those sons of Peachy's doctors won't give him back his teeth.
So we went around to Otay.
and they were being inspected, and the comandante of all the Mexican aduanas, of all the Mexican border stuff, was there doing inspection. He came out, "What do you want?" You know, and I said, "Well, you know," I went into my super, you know, high-speed missionary rap. "Oh, look, poor person, do you want to dump me the house? Nice young woman, got babies, going to divorce, steal the house." And he listened to me, you know, and he said, "What do you want from me?" And I said, "I need a note giving him permission to take the wood in from me." He said, "Oh, I guess I can do that." And so he started to write it, and I said, "Oh, by the way, if you're going to write me that, could you make it okay for two bullets?" And his assistant said, "Comandante, you can't do that." And machismo saved me, because the guy got mad and said, "I'm the one who says what can be done around here, not you. I'll let him bring all the way on, so come on in." It was one of those unexpected blessings, you know. So we took her to the wood, and everybody in the little neighborhood came, and we had sort of a barn raising where everybody helped her build this house. So, you know, they've got a house, and I've taken a lot of people to meet her. Oddly enough, she's become the famous one out of the book. Everybody wants to meet Nevia. So she's been on TV quite a bit. People have donated cars to them. She's kind of nice. And you know, you can't save the world, unfortunately, and that's something I realized, but I give her 10% of my earnings for my writing, you know, to know that I'm doing something, which sounds really noble, but it means like, you know, 40 bucks every 2 years. You know? That's how rich I am. But at least it's something. And she's got a phone now, too. So I forgot to bring her number. You guys could all call her up, you know. Uh-oh, they're coming to get me. Are we done?
No.
Oh, we're done.
We just want to thank Luis once more for coming. He's agreed to meet students who'd like to speak with him in the lobby. There are also books that are there for sale, and you can find them. And on behalf of World Cultures, we want to have this token of our appreciation.
Anticipate.